No apology.
No apology.
We will not back down.
In this test, I'm doing a before and after run using Acrobat and also Photoshop. Here is a 400 dpi scan of a genuine 1961 birth certificate. As you can see, it's a single image. Left-hand column shows the contents of the PDF. I'm going to apply adaptive compression to it. I set the quality to high. I have all of the filters turned off, such as the background removal and text sharpening. And OCR is off. Very important. Okay. The first thing you're going to notice when this finishes is that we're going to go from a single image to two. Here are two objects. Well, instead we had one. We have one on the top and one on the bottom. We're going to show here how that top layer is in fact the black part of the image. The black text and the black lines. And this is exactly what adaptive compression is designed to do, to separate out that monochromatic black and white from the rest of the document. In this test, I'm going to open up the same document that I had before, the original scanned document was scanned as a PDF into Adobe Acrobat X, and then I'm going to do some manipulation to it. Specifically, what I'm going to do is I'm going to enhance the background using Unsharp Mask. What Unsharp Mask does is create a duplicate layer of this image, blurs it, and then sharpens it and adds it back in. You don't actually see that step, but you can see immediate results of what happens when you adjust the different values. The radius is the distance in pixels that we're going to go out from the original. Threshold adjusts the contrast between the darkest part and the rest of the part. In other words, if it will reduce the amount of sharpening done to other areas of the certificate beyond the text. And we're going to set it to 130. Then we're going to go ahead and save it as a copy, so that we don't go over our original. And then we're going to open that back up in Acrobat. And here is our sharpened document. It's still a single image, as you can see. Here I'm applying adaptive compression using the same settings as we had before. Remember, this is how we do controlled experiments. We change one thing at a time. And you saw how it went white. Now we have a separation as we did before, but we have something different. What we have here is not all of the top layer contains all of the text from the background. What we see is that we have of live attached to the top and certificate birth still as a part of the background. Also, if you notice that the text, the shadow, the what I call the residue from the black text and lines actually is darker. There's more of it left behind than was the case in our first run where there was no sharpening. Okay, you can see the of live that's part of the text layer. I'm going to switch back to this image. It's in Photoshop still, and I'm going to save it as a bitmap file. You can apply the same optimization routines to it, which is what I'm going to do here. So I'm saving it as a bitmap, Windows BMP file. So I'm going to create a PDF file from that bitmap image that I just saved in Photoshop. I'm also increasing the background removal. We still have only two images, but there has been a change to that top text layer. Basically looks identical to what we had before using the scanned PDF directly. Now I'm doing a quick check of preferences to see how BMP files are translated, and I'm seeing here that the default, or at least what I have set up here, is for the background removal to be high and text sharpening high, and that's why in the previous run the background was pretty much wiped out. I'm going to turn that off so that we can be consistent. And now redo the test. This is the BMP file that I saved in Photoshop, and I'm bringing it back into Acrobat X and is treating it as if it were a scan. We're getting the same result as we did with the original PDF, which was a scan of an actual birth certificate. So Adobe X, Adobe 10, Acrobat 10, treats a bitmap, a BMP file, as if it were an original scan, and that's a unique feature. Now that I know that Adobe Acrobat 10 will treat bitmap images as if they're scans, I can experiment with files that I've converted to bitmaps, actually a JPEG that I converted to a bitmap. All right, but here, this is the printout of Allen's 1963 BC that I enlarged 400%. And I printed out on my inkjet printer on a sheet of security paper. You'd never find a certificate this big, but what I'm attempting to do here, and I've gone through all kinds of different hoops to do it, is to reproduce that whitish outline found on Obama's birth certificate and see if it's something that is a consequence of scanning. This is Adobe Acrobat 7, and if you look at the right side, you see that there are a lot of images that are created. There's only one image having the top layer, having the text, in other words, the black lines, the black text separated out from the remainder, and that's a single image. That's a single layer. So you'd never have a situation where there'd be one additional layer, or two, or three, or four, as it was in Obama's PDF. There'll always be one and only one separate monochromatic layer, or image, or PostScript object, more correctly defined. Now, the first one was a test I ran using a printout of the image that I had applied on Sharp Mask 2. This is just the straight image, and there was no enhancements done. And what I'm trying to find here is the difference between unsharp mask, what that does to the image, versus one that does not have any kind of enhancements, the halos that people were talking about. And you can see quite readily that the background looks very different from the previous one, which had the unsharp mask. You don't see any of that whitish halo effect that you saw in the previous one. You have less of a separation. Here is a scan that I made of the printout that was increased in contrast, and I'm going to save it as a bitmap. Again, this is a bitmap created from a scan. I'm saving it in Photoshop as a 16-bit bitmap. And then what I'm going to do is I'm going to open up the bitmap image in Acrobat 10 to see what the effect is. So create from file. I'm going to open up the bitmap I just created. And it comes in as a single image here. And then what I'm going to do, first of all, I'll show you that we only have a single image, a single object right there. Here I'm actually running a scan from within Photoshop. This is the software you're looking at that came with the scanner, and the software has numerous controls over what the output will look like. Here I'm increasing the contrast of the final image before it's scanned into Photoshop. So again, it's a legitimate enhancement of an image using the scanner software. It's not really manipulating it to look like it's a forgery or to look like it's anything that's real. It's just an enhancement. Again, you have to differentiate between what's legitimate and what's not. I'm going to run several scans and do different adjustments to them. In some cases I will increase the contrast, in others I will make it lighter. Now the reason I'm making it lighter here is because I'm going to take that top text and graphic layer created in Acrobat, and I'm going to use that as a template and overlay it on top of a piece of security paper, or should I say an image I created of security paper. Here is my text template that actually was created thanks to Acrobat 10. I'm going to drag that layer right on top of my security paper image in Photoshop. I've created it here. I'm going to, what I need to do is I need to pull the security paper layer below the template like that. On the left is just the security paper. It's a bitmap image. And then once I've copied that over, I'll move it underneath so that it essentially totally underlies my certificate. I need to crop it because the sheet of security paper was a full-size page and I needed only the size of a certificate. So that's what I'm doing. I'm going to reopen the test run I used with the 400% increase and scan on Allen's 1963 BC. What I'm going to do is compare the background of that to the background of the Obama BC. Remember, in the Obama BC, we had this weird-looking whitish outline along with pieces of the template or text layer, text and line. I'm going to compare that background to what I did, albeit artificially, with the Allen 1963 BC. Remember, the image on the right is one that I enlarged 400%. I applied unsharp mask, printed it off on security paper, then scanned it back in to Acrobat 10 in order to achieve this effect. So in no way can we say that the two are comparable, but the point is I was trying to recreate this effect any way I could and still stay within the boundaries of acceptability, if you will. Okay. The difference here, what I discovered is that this background with the white was actually a separate layer. It was actually created separately, saved as a low quality JPEG, and then meshed or merged back with the rest of the document. Okay, we remove the top line. And one of the things that I saw immediately was that inside the outline, this whitish outline, you can make out a dark gray inset that matches the layer that was removed from the top. You can't really do that with Obama's, and that's one of the primary differences. This concludes part one. Please continue by watching part two.
No apology. No apology. We will not back down. No apology.
The first step in the recreation of Obama's PDF birth certificate is to create the black and white template into which all the information will be entered. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to crop the certificate part of the PDF and then convert that to a black and white template. Now there's more than one way to do that. One way is to lower the number of colors in the document from whatever the number is to 2, black and white. You can do that through the posterize command. You can set it to 2 levels, black and white. That's one way to do it. Or if you want more precise control, you can go to the black and white tool or feature and then max out the intensity of all the colors. I'll leave green for last because green is the color of the background, and therefore that would be the one we would want to have the most control over. If we set it too high, we may wind up wiping out the text itself and the field headers. We don't want to do that. So we'll get it close between 200 and 300. And then we have our template. The next step would be to remove the white background and essentially make this black on transparent, as if it was a film with a black image on it. The first comparison we're going to make, the first sample, is the Nordic birth certificates, which some have said served as the basis for Obama's birth certificate. There's some merit to that in that there are some similar looking features, such as the certificate number and the dates, the handwritten dates. And of course the time that this was allegedly completed within 17 hours of Obama's birth. So you would expect the forms to be the same hospital. So to that extent, we're going to save that and then compare it to the 2 birth certificates, one for Gretchen and one for Susan. And what I've found is that Gretchen's is the better match than Susan's. So I'm going to use that for this comparison. First thing that you notice is that the lines of the form do not match up. The Obama birth certificate has some curved lines. Also, Gretchen's certificate is tilted to the right. So in order to get this thing lined up in the beginning, we need to rotate the Obama template slightly until we get the horizontal and vertical lines approximately the same. You'll also notice that Gretchen's birth certificate does have a curvature along the left side, the gutter margin. Now, the fit starts to break down, as you can see, as we move further down to the bottom, that we may get the top aligned fairly readily, but the bottom doesn't want to line up very well. And that is a characteristic of the form, the birth certificate form, whatever was used in Obama's PDF, in that it is twisted in a way. It's not really straight. It's not really shot at an angle, but is twisted. The lines are not following the perspective that you would expect if this was just a simple curvature of a document inserted in a book. So what I'm doing here is I'm using the warp transformation in Photoshop, and I'm bending the lines top and bottom to get it to fit Gretchen's. It's a little bit of a exercise and frustration because just when you think you have one part lined up, the other part is off, and then you start tugging on that, and by the time you get done and looks everything like it's in place, take away the underlying example, Gretchen's, and then you have Obama's, and it's sort of twisted and warped. But anyway, this is a first start, and this will be one of many certificates that I will compare to Obama's to see if I can identify if an existing form was used. Now, of course, this doesn't rule out the possibility that the forger had
a blank form or one that we don't know about. And consequently, I'm going to also use a 1961 birth certificate from August that is flat, that I know is genuine, and use that and try that to see if I can match it to Obama's. So here I finally have fitted Obama's to Gretchen Nordyke's. As I said, the certificate number on Gretchen Nordyke's looks very similar to Obama's, or vice versa. So I'm going to see if I can create one from the other. The first thing I'm doing is I'm cutting out Obama's certificate number, and then I'm going to align it over Gretchen's. And you can see it probably needs to be slightly rotated upwards, but the spacing on the elevation of the 0 and the 6 relative to the 1 and 4 appears to match the stamp here, as you might expect if someone were using a Bates numbering stamp and it was set to give you the first three numbers and just change the last two during this time frame. It doesn't exactly match. It still needs to probably be rotated slightly more, but the 106 definitely is a match here. Again, this doesn't mean that Gretchen Nordyke served as the basis for it, but it is suggestive that it may have been used. And in fact, the Obama birth certificate form was a compilation of many different parts from several other 1961 through 1963 birth certificates. Now, for certain words that didn't fit, rather than trying to rotate the whole form, I move the words, like health. Now I'm just going to adjust the transparency so we can compare with the one number to the other. It's pretty much finished. There were some other little tricks I had to do, like to get Kapi'olani to fit in. Since it's on a curve, I had to cut and paste the individual letters. But now I'm ready to create the black-on transparent template. I use the magic wand to highlight the white area and delete that. So now I have the black template on a transparent background. I also noticed that the handwritten dates on Gretchen Nordyke's certificate look similar to what appears on Obama's. Obama's numbers look similar to Gretchen's, at least at the top number, that 8761, so I'm going to go ahead and use that number in my compilation. Also, the 8861 looks similar. What I'm going to do is, here I created a template, I'm going to use that 81161 and Photoshop to make 8861. Here is my finished template, and I'm going to lay it on top of a sheet of, quote, security paper, just to get an idea of how it looks. I'll go ahead and paste it on there. Actually, I'll copy the background and paste it as a layer underneath this template. I've opened up Illustrator on the left side and put Illustrator next to Photoshop. I'm creating an artboard for my Illustrator PDF recreation. It's going to be 8.5 by 11. And there's the artboard. And then what I'm going to do is I'm going to bring over that layer and put it in the artboard. If that doesn't work, then I'm going to go ahead and paste it. But if I want to retain the layer structure, then what I really need to do is to open up the Photoshop file in Illustrator, and it will retain the layer structure. Now, you notice here that the rotation factor is 0 in the Adobe PDF for Obama's birth certificate. It was minus 90, which is portrait orientation. Landscape orientation is 0 degrees, and so when you rotate it 90 degrees clockwise, it actually is minus 90 degrees. That means the original was brought in as landscape and then rotated 90 degrees to the right clockwise. And if you look under the links section of Illustrator, you'll see that. Go ahead and click that and rotate it. Transform. We'll type in minus 90 degrees. And that's why when you click on the link, that's why everything is minus 90 degrees, because it was brought in as 0 degrees as landscape and then rotated to portrait orientation. In fact, the entire compilation can be rotated, the entire image can be rotated. Now here's something what I did to confirm that. I opened up the PDF inside Photoshop, and look, the background sheet, the main body here is landscape orientation. So in fact, that confirms it began its life as an image that was landscape orientation, brought into Illustrator, and then rotated 90 degrees clockwise, which I'm going to do right now. Okay. And pretty much all of the different links that were found in Obama's PDF were brought in the same way. They were brought in at 0 degrees, which is landscape, and then all rotated clockwise 90 degrees. Now keep in mind I have two birth certificates to recreate. I have the one that appears in the PDF posted on the White House website, as well as the large one, high resolution one, that was given out to the media at the press conference. That being the case, I need to find an example that is as high a resolution as that. And I happen to have that, thanks to Jerry Corsi and WorldNet Daily. One of their readers provided them with an actual birth certificate for her, as well as one for her child, too, so that we can see the evolution of them. And so here I'm going to use hers as my template. As I did with Gretchen Nordyke's birth certificate, I've taken the template I created for Obama and going to overlay that over this one, which I'll nickname J.A. and J.A.'s birth certificate, and attempt to match the curves and the positioning of Obama's with hers. Notice, too, that her birth certificate was also signed by UICLE. I don't believe it's UKLE, but I've seen this signature in four different birth certificates, so I tend to believe that it was there, or this person existed. I'm going to align everything, and what I found is that fitting Obama's birth certificate to JA's and vice versa was a lot easier. I didn't have to go through any of the special rotation for Gretchen's. This is the end of part two. Please watch part three.
No apology, no apology. We will not back down.
One of the signs of forgery that I look for are characters and letters and objects that are repeated within the document. But for this series, I'm going to show how I constructed the name of the street address using the name of the hospital. Kapiolani Maternity and Gynecological Hospital has a lot of vowels and consonants that also are found in Kalani Anoli Highway. In particular, you can see right off of the bat that the L-A-N-I of Kapiolani can be copied and pasted as part of it. We'll line that up. What else do we need? We can see the K-A in Kapiolani. The K-A can also be used for the K-A in highway name. We need a A-O-L-E. We have the O-L-L from Kapi'olani. And as we're going along, I mean, we're not really concentrating on getting them totally aligned. We'll go back and clean it up and make sure that they're all straight along the baseline. Now, you have to remember which layer you had your source. Okay, here's the A from Eternity. I could have reused the A from LANI, but I don't want to make it too obvious. All right, so we have, we need an E. We can get that from Eternity, or we can get that from Gynecological. We'll take it from Eternity and add that. Now, when you copy and paste it, it doesn't always paste it right over where you want it. All right, so basically we have the name of the highway, Kalani Anaoli. And now we're going to construct highway. I'm going to go ahead and type in what the name of this layer is so that I'll remember it. We can take the H from hospital to use for highway, which we're doing here. We have, looking across, we've got the G from gynecological we can use, the I from many different places. We have a lowercase H that we have to find from another source. And the O, we have the A, we have the Y, here's the G. Okay, now what I'm going to do is cut off just the G part and use the I for the I in highway, as I'm doing here. It's very tedious, and even though this may be the way the forger created the entries on this form, it certainly is not the most expedient way of doing it. It says very time consuming. We need a W, and actually there's plenty of W's around because we have the word Hawaii, which has W, but here we have the Y for maternity. And we still need to get that lowercase H and find out where we can get that from. So we may need to do a little searching. And we have the A here in way from gynecological. We still need that W. And we'll go and search. And see, here we are. Here's what we have so far. We need a W and we need an H. So where are we going to find a W, and where are we going to find a H? W we can get from Hawaii. Where are we going to get the H from? Although I can get the W from Hawaii, I thought it'd be fun to show you how you can take a capital letter and make it into a lowercase one. And just in case we don't have a particular letter, we can kind of manufacture it. And seeing as how these letters are not really very high in resolution, we can kind of get away with that. So there's our W. Later on, I'll go and get the W from Hawaii, since we have two Hawaiis to choose from, at least. Once we've assembled all of our letters, we're going to make sure they're all in alignment. Get them all in alignment, and then we will clean them up. We'll go around the letters and take out any excess. But you see, we got all these separate layers from the letters and letter combinations we pasted. What we need to do is we need to merge all these layers into a single layer representing the name of the street. Again, we want to do that as a last step after we've gotten all these letters aligned. After merging the letters together into a single layer, I'm going to go through and clean up all the junk around them so that we have nothing but black letters on a transparent background, just like I have or will have for the entire template. And that's a simple process, that's using the magic wand to highlight the background and then cutting it off. And that's what will be done for the entire black text and form template. It looks a little bit like the original, doesn't it? See, there's another reason for going through this process, because if you have a result that matches what is on the forgery, then you can feel confident in saying that this is the methodology used by the forger to create this particular date entry, in other words, the name of the highway. And it's an uncanny fit. Remember, we took out the L, A, N, I. We basically took 95% of this from the name of the hospital, and the letters, with their idiosyncrasies, look very similar to what was here. So we can confirm for the moment that this is how the forger actually created the name of the highway. It may not be for the rest of the entries, but certainly it looks like this was the method used. The letters match up, I'd say, at least 95% or more. Another post-processing step that I take in case the letters look too raggedy is to use the Gaussian blur to smooth out the jaggies of the letters. And you want to use a very low amount here. You can also go back and use unsharp mask, and the combination of the two will give you the result that you're looking for. You're trying to get it to match the original. Here I have it set way too high. You want to be careful with this. You can go overboard too. Now, let me add here that the repeated usage of the Gaussian blur followed by unsharp mask changes the shapes of the letters. It makes it thin in places and thick in places, and that may account for some of the variability that other people have observed in the individual layers. Now, in order to get this background, we have to create the entire black text template and form first. The shadow you see along the left edge here is actually a gradient that the forger drew in. It's not a real shadow. I'm also going to demonstrate that. This back part is the most complex element, a component, of the entire certificate. For many reasons. For one, it has a separate piece, if you will, of security paper. It's got the whitish outline. It's got the grayish inset. It has the grid, the lines of the form. It's got pieces of letters on it, and it's got the gradient. So that center piece, that back right here with some of the signatures, as well as pieces of letters still attached to it, is the most complex part of this entire contraption, Frankenstein document. So all these pieces have to be done independently and then combined together to form this back layer, that goes on top of a full page sheet of security paper, in quotes, because it's not real security paper. Like everything else, however, I have to manufacture the security paper, which is what I've done here using pieces of other security paper. If you notice, the color doesn't match, so I have to change the coloring of my sample of security paper so that it matches Obama's. And I'm going to do that using color balance. I'm pretty good at eyeballing it. I have a good eye for color, so that's essentially what I'm doing here. And then when I'm done adjusting the color, the lightness of the background in between the green patterns also has to be lightened, has to be increased. Now that I have the color approximated, the next and final step actually in the making the background is to get the space in between the green patterns, the color, to be lighter so as to match what's shown here on the right. And the way that I do that is same way I did in the cold, was I use a magic wand to select the lighter green background, and then I'm going to use the hue, saturation, lightness control. I'm going to make that background lighter. Okay, what I did there was I expanded my selection so to make sure they include all of the background. And then I'm going to increase the lightness, as I'm doing here. Again, this is strictly a visual process. And once I get the color I want, I deselect. And you can see that it approximates. It doesn't. I'm not going to try to get it exactly, because you can see on the right that the green patterns are a little bit thinner and have some white around them. That's the result of the adaptive compression routine in Acrobat. It may have been simulated by the forger using the unsharp mask, but for the moment the color and pattern is pretty much the same. So since there's going to be an additional manipulations done, we'll see what happens after we get done with them. I'm doing a quality control check here. I've saved the security paper background as a bitmap file, opened it up, and dragged over the top layer along with other pieces of the Obama template so that I can compare it to my background and see what needs to be done next. This is a little bit far into the development, but I wanted to show you how this certificate area, the hardest part of this whole construction, had to be done first, and how I duplicated the gradient on the left side to give it that shadow effect of a gutter margin, just like it was done in the Obama certificate. Now, you see, and then that section, it's a big section, big group of layers, was placed on top of the full page security paper. There's that gradient all by its lonesome. That's something I had to repeatedly try until I got it right, and so that's why it's its own separate layer. Again, if I make a mistake, I can always go back and redo it, and then when I'm sure I've got what I want, then I can combine it with the rest of the document until we get to the final stage, which they're in the same layers or objects in the same order as they appeared in the PDF file.
No apology, no apology. We will not back down.
In this part, I'm going to demonstrate how some of the entries on the Obama's birth certificate were created. Some of the entries I used a computer font that resembles an old typewriter, and for others, like the street address here, the Kalani Anaoli Highway, I'm actually going to copy and paste the letters from the name of the hospital, Kapiolani Maternity and Gynecological Hospital. In that name are almost all the letters that I need to reproduce the name of the highway. In fact, we have the L-A-N-I right off the bat, and you can see that's a pretty good fit. Then we look and see what else do we need. We need a K-A. We can take the K-A directly from Kapiolani. Each time we do this, we have to make sure we're going back to the background, which is, I'm using Obama's birth certificate, but we can use Kapiolani from any other certificate that emanated from there during the same time frame. This is also performing another test to see if the forger actually used letters that were already existing in whatever certificate that became the template. And there is evidence of that, for example, with the father's name, Barack Hussein Obama, being copied and pasted up for the son's name, and just having to add the two capital I's afterwards. We have the A and N, again, from, we can reuse that from Lonnie Capiolani. We need an A and an O and an L and an E, and there are a lot of O's. There's two in gynecological. There's another A there that we can take. Again, we go back to the source of the letters being Obama's birth certificate. So we're going to take the OL from Capiolani and drop it in there for the AO. Now, if you notice that this, don't worry about how you cut out the letters here, because at the end we're going to remove any of the excess background that we copied over. It's just faster to do this. We're going to have a lot of layers when we're done, obviously, because we have all these individual letters and combinations of letters. The process is not that different from creating a ransom note. Have you ever seen movies where they create a ransom note using letters from different newspapers? It's kind of like that in a way. We are typesetting these letters by hand. And one thing we need to make sure of is getting them all aligned on the baseline. When we're all done, we can actually compare what we've created to what is existing in Obama's birth certificate and perhaps confirm that this was the method used, at least for the name of the street address in Obama's birth certificate. So one of the two main questions that I needed to answer is, what became the source of the letters? How are the data fields completed? We know from some of the typesetting experts and typewriter experts that the individual letters in Obama's birth certificate look differently from one another. They look almost as if they were done by different typewriters, which may be the case. These letters may have been drawn from other certificates, or it may be a consequence of that typewriter font, the computer typewriter font, that are intentionally designed to look different from one another as a way to reflect the variability, the natural variability that exists in typewriters, at least with old typewriters. Again, we go back to our source to get these letters. We have a Y from maternity. And what else do we need? We need a G, which you can get from gynecological, and we have an H, which we'll have to find another source to get. Here's the A from gynecological. This is a very time-consuming process, and I would like to think that the forger just simply found a typewriter font. That's what we have so far, by the way. Above that is our source that we've cut up in building this. This gives us an idea of what other letters we need. We need a G and we need an H. Of course, we need the 6085. That's going to be somewhat problematic. Finding numbers, Hawaiian street addresses seem to have similar vowels in them, so there's no shortage of vowels. The numbers will be a problem. Where are we going to get the W from? We can get it from Hawaii. There's Hawaii on a number of occasions. We get the H from Oahu. Although I'm going to do something a little differently with the W, and you'll see that in a minute. Okay, then we're looking over our product so far, and that W is basically the last letter we need to add before we go hunting for numbers. What I decided to do was here, see if you could take a capital W and convert it into a lowercase w. Basically just did it for the heck of it and to show that in instances where letters are not readily available, they can be manufactured on demand simply by virtue of being in Photoshop and having the capabilities to resize, to twist, warp, and bend them in such a way as to make them resemble what you want as a final product. That's what I've done here. I've manufactured a W, and the W that I made from a capital letter is not that bad. Again, we want to check the alignment of our letters. The way that we do that is we reduce the opacity, increase the transparency so we can see the letters underneath. And then we're going to need to find the numbers, which I found off another certificate, by the way. Here we're reducing the opacity of the background as a way to see how our top level of letters correspond. Like I said, we have multiple layers. Once we're done, we're going to combine all these multiple layers, which are letters and groups of letters, into a single layer, and then that will be merged with our background along with the other letters, the other type. Another way that we can check easier than having to adjust the transparency is if we change the blending from normal to dark, and when we do that, then the dark letters appear and the color background drops away. Here I'm just basically changing them all to darken so that I can look through them and I can compare them to what appears on Obama's birth certificate. Keep in mind, I did not use any of the letters from Kalani Anoli Highway. They all came from Kapiolani Maternity and Gynecological Hospital. So I'm getting all these lined up. Like I said, very tedious process, but it's doable, and it is one explanation of how this information was entered into our template. Or I should say, into the template that the forger created. Once we're happy with what we got here, we can combine them. Essentially, click on the bottom layer, click on the top layer. I'm grouping them together as opposed to merging them just to make sure that this is exactly what I want. Now I've merged them together and changing the blending to darken. I'm going to go back and change Obama's birth certificate, our background layer, back to its original, so we can make the comparison. Now we're going to clean up these letters, and one way we're going to do that is to use the magic wand to highlight the black text. We have to make sure to unclick the box that says contiguous. once we do that, we're going to delete the background around the layers. Once we select it, we also have to expand the selection so to make sure that we're not cutting off any of the letters, which I just did. It just cleared out the background. And then we can go in and take our eraser and erase any of the stray lines and pieces of background, as you see here. And I'm not concerned that there's some white. I can knock that off again by using the magic wand. What I'm doing here. I can repeat it, and every time I repeat it, it always takes a little bit more of the background. So now we have just the black text, and I'm lining it up against Obama's birth certificate. Here, I just turned off the layer. And it really does look like the forger could have used Kapiolani Hospital, the name, and all the letters from there, to create at least this entry. We still have to get that 6085, but for the most part, you can see that there is a 95% match here in the letters. This is the end of part four of the four-part video. To get a tour of what the final product wound up to be, please watch Forensic Reconstruction.